2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me? 1, 2, 3. Good evening. Today is March 14th, year 2000. We are in the home of Agnes McCready in Roscommon, and she's going to do an oral history for us. So now, Agnes, if you would say that this tape will belong to the Roscommon Area Historical Society.
This tape will belong to the Roscommon Area Historical Society.
Okay. We'll start out with a little bit of a background on your parents, if you don't mind.
Okay. I can tell you that my parents were born in Austria, and they both came to Illinois, to America. I can't tell you the years, but my mother was about 18. My father was maybe 22 or so. And my mother went to Chicago to be with an aunt.
Did they come through Ellis Island?
Yes, they both came to Ellis Island. And my mother went to Chicago, and she came here to help an aunt who had a husband who had cancer of the throat.
Oh.
And my aunt, her aunt, had a store, a small store, which we would today designate as a party store, probably. And she had two small children, and so my mother came to help her with the store and with the children. And to take care of his sick husband. My father came over here to work on a farm with an uncle, his Uncle John, and this was in Wisconsin. I don't know exactly where it was.
Okay. What were your parents' names?
My father's name, of course, was Joseph Wagner. My mother's name was Mary Margreiter. So when they met in Milwaukee at the home of mutual friends, they didn't know each other in Austria, but they found out they only lived a few miles apart.
Oh, isn't that cute?
Mm-hmm. But went to different schools, and you know, it was all different. And but they had these mutual friends, and they met there on a Sunday afternoon. And my mother had come from Chicago to Milwaukee by boat. So my father went home with her by boat that night and came back. You know, escorted her home. And that's how he courted her, I guess.
Oh, isn't that neat? Okay, we're gonna check it. So how did you end up in, how did your family happen to come to Roscommon County?
Well,
they didn't come to Roscommon County, did they?
No, they came to Roscommon County. Well, my mother and father moved to Chicago and had seven children there. And this was during the First World War period. And after the war, I mean, during that time, prices got really high. And Dad and Mother decided living in the city, was a large family, was quite expensive. And at that time, we had friends who had moved from Chicago to El Dorado, to homestead land. And there were several parcels of land to be homestead, and they were all 160 acres. And one of our friends wrote to us, wrote to my dad, and told him that there was one parcel of land, 160 acres, left there in the area to be homesteaded, and suggested that we come, that he come and look it over. And he did. And when he came back, he told about it. And they let us have a vote on it.
Oh, all seven of you?
Well, my oldest sister was married by that time, and my second oldest sister was not going to leave Chicago. She was 18 or 19 and couldn't make up her own mind, and she decided to stay in Chicago, and she would live with my sister and her husband and little girl. And so we all decided we would like to live on the farm. My dad painted quite a glowing picture of the trees and, sure, and all that. So we came to Roscommon. And we came to Roscommon in early November of 1918. And my first view and memory of Roscommon is getting off the train on a frosty morning in November and seeing this little depot with yellow lamplight or lantern light, they had lanterns in there, shining through the window. And all of us stumbling out of the train, sleepy and cold and hungry. And we were met by the depot agent, as he was called. And his name was Happy Preston.
Oh.
And he was the jolliest, friendliest, nicest man that anyone could meet on a cold morning like that. Oh, yes. And we went into this depot, and the fire was burning, and it was warm, and there were benches around, and the lamps were light, with the lanterns.
Early in the morning?
4 o'clock. Mm-hmm. So we all got settled in there, and of course, my mother and dad started talking to Happy, and he told us all about his family. Mm-hmm. And his family were the Preston girls, you know. Bertha Carpenter was one of his daughters.
Oh, yeah.
Evelyn Ballou was another daughter, and Helen Murphy. These were his three daughters, and his sons were Lovell and Ed Preston. And I didn't know it then, but I got to know all of them well, except Ed. I never did know Ed. But in later life, I knew all of these children and really became very fond of them. We're all good friends with all of them. And today I know their children and their grandchildren. But he told us how happy he was in his marriage and with his family. And my mother and dad couldn't wait for a cup of coffee or something warm. And also they asked when the hotels or someplace would open up a restaurant where we could have something warm to eat or drink. I don't know if it would have been the Northern Hotel or it was a hotel close to the depot. This was 1918. So I don't know which hotel would have been in existence then. But they said they would be open at 6 o'clock and would be making coffee. So we were all over there as soon as they were opened up and had something warm. Of course, it's children and had coffee or something. And then we had to wait for Mr. Weber, who was our neighbor, who was the man who'd written us about the homestead, which was next to his. And he came with his team of horses and a big farm wagon to take us to his place, because we stayed there for 3 weeks before they...
Did you have all your clothes with you on the train?
I guess so. We didn't have all our furniture, I don't think. I think that came by freight later or something, you know, and they probably put in the warehouse at the freight depot until we could pick it up. But this homestead had been occupied by a man and his wife, and they had a small house on it and a barn, a nice big log barn. So there were about 10 acres or so cleared. And but the wife had died and the man had committed suicide. So it was up again for the taking. And so they had to, I think they built out 2 bedrooms or something before we moved into it. And so we stayed at the Webers until it was ready for us. And I remember that first winter, it was exciting for all of us. School was right at the corner of the Weber property, which was about an eighth of a mile from our house. We could see the house. My mother said it was so nice to be able to see her children walk to school and walk. We all came home for a hot lunch. But of course, at that time, that first winter, we didn't have any how cows or horses or chickens or dogs or cats or anything, just us, you know, yeah. Because we're just new. But I don't remember too much about it, except I remember I didn't like school. I liked the teacher. She was pretty. Uh-huh. And I remember her name. And my sister and I, about 10
sister
years,
Anne.
My sister Anne and I, about 10 years ago, went to hunt her up to visit her. And she was in a nursing home. No, she was in an apartment in Fairview at that time.
What was her name?
Millie Hageman. And she married Reed Cripps, and her married name was Cripps. But we both remembered her with fondness, uh-huh. And she remembered us.
Yes, she,
mm-hmm. She remembered us and was very happy to see us.
Sure.
And she was in her 80s, and she's died since. But we did look her up. And I wrote a note to her that first winter, and I said, I remember what I wrote in the note. I wrote, dear teacher, I used to like school in Chicago because we had lots to do and they kept us busy, but I do not like school here because there isn't enough to do. So she called me up, and she read her note, and she said, Agnes, do you see that big box in the corner? And I said, yes. Well, she said, you go over there and you look inside it and you pick out any books that you want. They were kind of discarded textbooks, all grades and all kinds, some of the pages missing and so on. She says, you pick out any books you want and you read them. She said, if you want to pick out a fourth grade arithmetic and you want to get to work in that, you do the work and I'll correct it. So I think that's what I did. It was a challenge and I just loved it. I could work at my own speed, and so that made me like school better. And
how many students were in that school?
Well, there were Andrew, Anne, Agnes, George. Joe was too small. Joe was four years old. There were four of us, and there were three of the Kreischers. That's seven, and Emma were eight of us. Uh huh. Uh-huh. There were three families. A single girl from that walked over two miles.
Is that school building still there?
Oh, no. It's been long gone. Long gone. And the next year, I wasn't there. The next year, I went to Techne, Illinois with my aunt and uncle. And I stayed there a year. And I loved everything about that, except that I wasn't home. I was homesick, so the next summer I went home and stayed home after that. But we loved the animals, we loved the trees, we loved the wildflowers, we loved the freedom, we loved picking berries. We really liked a lot of things about.
Did your mother like it pretty much too?
My mother always said she was going back to Chicago. Many of us said we were all going back to Chicago, but in the meantime, we were making the best of us where we lived. And my mother and dad struggled to improve the land, and my dad, of course, had to. In order to homestead land, you have to make improvements, and you have to clear a certain number of acres every year. You have to live there the full year round. You can't just homestead land and then go back to the city and earn money and just hang on to the land, pay taxes. I mean, you have to really show that you're making that your home. And so it was an uphill battle to do that. And
so what did you make a living on, the crops or the animals?
Both.
Mm-hmm.
We worked hard. And it was a big thing for us when he bought his first team of horses. He bought them from the Hollowells out here. And it was a big thing when he got his plow and his disc and all those things. That, to us, that was modern, you know. That was progress. So anyway, and then we got cows and we had calves and we, you know, started having our own meat and improving our herd, and we had chickens, and we had, life got a little easier every year, you know. And,
Did your mother, did your happy mother come home?
Oh, did I ever. From the first seed to the last jar in the basement, I was in on every activity.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yes. We had to carry water on dry spells, you know, and water the garden row by row by row by row. We had to pump the water. No, our food was precious to us. We worked for it. But we had the best. It was all organic, all fresh, and all fresh canned when it was fresh picked, you know, really the best.
How about when your dad would let you come into town?
Oh, yes. When we were first out there, coming to town was quite an episode,
yeah,
because
huh?
For one thing, we had to come by horse and wagon, because we came to buy big supplies of things, you know, a barrel of this and a barrel of that, and we didn't come often, so it was a real treat, and Dad would take one of us children for a treat, so it came my turn, and it was a day in June, and I was just beside myself. I could hardly stand it that I was going to town. I was the chosen one. And I don't remember any other trip after that. I just remember this first trip to town with my dad after we moved out. Like it was yesterday. Mm-hmm. And we went, I don't know how many roads and what kind of roads, but he chose roads that took us through. There were two small lakes. There was Hunter's Lake and Jim West Lake now, and they're both dried up. But we drove along the edges of those lakes and drove right through the water to kind of firm up the wheels on the wagon. It would, you know, swell them up. Yes. Uh-huh. And we stopped there and let the horses drink and cool off. And even that was exciting to me. And then we got to town, and Dad, I think Louis Sackrider had a stable, livery stable, and we put our horses in there, and went to Price's grocery store, and that was the big grocery store. Well, it was about 1920 or so, you know, 1920, and we had a list, you know, a whole page long, because we had to stock up for a long time. We didn't go to town very often, and there was a big family. And everything was, Mother did everything from scratch. You know, you didn't buy quick fixes in those days. Everything was done from scratch, so we had to buy lots of lard and lots of flours and baking powder and sugar and, you know, all the things you started from scratch. And we had to wait a while for the horses to cool off and for all these things to get filled in the grocery store. And in those days, you gave the man your list. You didn't run around and pick things out. They did all the work. They did all the picking out. And so we just had time on our hands. So Dad and I took a walk. We walked all through town. And I was so excited. Here we were going all up down street, you know, and my father and I were walking, and I just loved my dad. I was so proud to be walking with him. And I remember walking under the down the streets, and they were not paved. I don't know whether even Main Street was paved in those days. This would be going way back. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. I know the side streets weren't, because I remember the street I remember as being the one that impressed me most, and I thought was most beautiful. All my life I remembered it. My dad and I walking, I guess right down the middle of the road, maybe, it'd be on Fifth Street, from the corner of Lake to the creek down there, you know, houses on both sides, and trees that just made an archway over the road. It was just beautiful. And I can remember the sunlight and the dappled look on the road, you know, the sunlight shadow. And we walked past a house, and it was the house second from the corner. McCready's was the corner, and then the house next to that. it was summer, so the screen door was there, and I could hear someone playing the piano. My dad and I just kind of paused and listened, and I thought, oh, whoever that person is, she's the luckiest person in the world. She lives in town on this pretty street, and she knows how to play the piano.
Oh, she had it all.
Yeah, I thought that person had it all. And I never did find out who that lucky person was. But I thought that was somehow one person I envied. And then when it came noontime, I guess Dad bought some sardines and maybe some cheese and crackers. We went down the river and ate. We had our lunch. And
river,
it was just woods then, you know.
Started early.
Oh yeah, I was a river lover. I was always loved water. And so then I remember loading up, you know, Dad picking up, getting the horses in the wagon and driving up to the store, and the clerks and everybody coming out and loading it up. And Mr. Price handed me a big brown paper sack full of candy. And that's what grocers did in those days. If somebody came in and bought a big order and they knew they had children, they always gave them free candy. And it was, the bigger the order, the bigger the sack, you know. So we had quite a big sack of candy. And I could hardly wait to get home to show my brothers what I brought home, you know. But that was one of the happy days of my childhood. That's a day that's remained in my memory. So then, you know, came someone else's turn, and I imagine they all thrilled to it. And I guess we went to town by horse for several years, and then my dad got a model, a used Model T car. So then we started going by car. Oh, that was exciting too.
How long did you go to that little school?
Oh, I think only 2 or 3 years. Then we went to Luzerne. We had to go by horse in the wintertime, horse and sled, which had a, well, it was covered wet.
How far was that?
Well,
about 5 or 7 miles?
Uh-huh, between that. Mm-hmm. 5, 6 miles. And the roads were not plowed.
Like
the roads were not plowed. And you just, well, we didn't go across fields. We had to follow because it was all woods or it was fenced. And, but we had to actually get out of the sled at times because the horses were just jumping through the snow drifts. And we had to walk back of the sled and sometimes almost push it. It was really tough sometimes. Uh-huh, yeah. And, but I don't remember that we ever missed a day. We went when you couldn't see, there was such a whiteout across the field, and the horses would be, my mother would wake us up at 5 o'clock, and she'd say, you have to get up today, there's a storm, and they'll be picking up early. And it was our neighbor who, the Kreitchers, who had children to go. They were just the two families.
Are you saying K-R-U-E-Z-E-R?
Uh-huh.
Oh.
And,
did they take turns taking the kids
in? Oh, no, but his job, he got paid for it by the bank.
Yeah.
And he did that for years and years. So anyway,
So in Luzerne, was that a bigger school?
Yes, 28 of us there.
Oh.
8th grade, 1st grade through 8th grade. Wonderful teachers, really wonderful teachers. Mm-hmm. And how they all did it, I don't know. But they got everybody had to learn. I mean, you had to know. You weren't passed until you knew everything that you're supposed to know. And you got flunked if you didn't. There weren't too many flunked. But, and then 7th and 8th grade, you had to pass a state exam. And you had to be, you know, you got the same questions was asked of every 7th and 8th grader in the whole state that came from money from larger schools, you know.
Sure.
But we had to answer.
What happened to all that?
I don't know. It was a good system. It was a better system.
So did you go there through your eighth grade?
Yes.
Then?
Oh, yeah.
Then where?
Yes. Bingo.
Oh. Well, you did all of that.
So then I
on. You want to tell that story?
Oh, well.
That's such a neat story.
Well, let me see. I'm trying to think how we met. Well, every one of us kids had to learn to drive the car. You know, when I was 14, my dad said, okay, you're going to have to learn to drive the car now. Fathers wouldn't say that today. They shudder with it. But we lived in the country, and Dad said, you know, anything could happen. We might need somewhere to go for help. And up until now, he was the only one that drove the car. So anyway, I was chosen. My mother never learned. Mm-mm. My mother was not mechanically minded, and wasn't interested in it, didn't want it. I don't think she even liked to ride in cars too well. No, I don't think she did. Anyway, we went to town once every week, every Friday, and
all of you?
No, sometimes it'd be my brother and I, sometimes it'd be my dad and I, sometimes it'd be me alone.
Oh.
But and we'd always have the grocery list, you know. And by now we were shopping at McCready's also, because they had a nice meat market. And I think prices. No, this was, yeah, right at the beginning. Prices hadn't burned down yet. I was going to say later on, Price Store burned down. But no, but McCready's had fresh fish brought in every morning, every Friday morning. And either train or a ice truck. I think they were fresh caught from the bay. They were just fresh caught fish, and I think they iced them and brought them either by truck. And I know they were wonderful fish. And I don't know now what kind of fish they were, whether they were walleye or perch or whatever they fished down there. But anyway, so we went to McCready's for fresh fish every Friday for sure. And I always had my grocery list, my meat list from the McCready's. And some of the other things we bought at prices, because we had shopped there for years, but I always got the meat and grilled fish from McCready's. And I was the one that always went there. So Everett, I guess, started noticing me. And one day when I went there for my fish and meats, I paid him, and he brought me the change. And as I held my hand out, he put his hand, and he held my hand in both of his, and asked me for a date.
Oh.
And he took me so by surprise, I didn't know what to say. And I said, well, I'll have to ask my dad first. And he said that's what he really liked about me, that I was the kind of girl who would ask her dad first. So anyway, I did. I went home and told my mother and dad what happened, and there were no objections. So I went back the next Friday and told him yes. So he had to wait a week for his answer. There were no phones then. I didn't have a phone anyway. And so he made a date for the following Sunday, and this was in November. And he came in a beautiful new car. It was a green car with black leather seats. It had to be leather because there was no vinyl then. And the car was, the name of it was Nash, and was made in Wisconsin. Nashes were made in Wisconsin. And he had bought it in Flint. And I didn't even know there was a Nash car. But it was beautiful. I was really impressed by it. So we were going to West Branch. It was our first, we were going to hear one of the first talking pictures. And this was really something, you know. I was all excited talking. And nobody up here, hardly anyone up here had heard anything like that. So we stopped in Roscommon and picked up Abe Mead, and he was dating Evelyn Preston at the time, who was boarding at the Richardsons because she was teaching school there.
Oh, okay.
So Evelyn Preston and Abe Mead were with us. And we got almost to West Branch going over some of those hills there, and the car started steaming up. And it just boiled. Oh, it was just steaming like crazy. So then, they took the cap off it and cooled it down, and we limped to the West Branch that way. Every little while we had to stop. At the top of every hill we had to stop and cool it down. And they knew what had happened. The belt had broken, fan belt, and was heating up. So we got into West Branch, and of course it was Sunday. In those days they didn't have businesses open on Sunday. We finally got, I think we found a Ford station or something that was open to sell gas and so on. And they didn't have a fan belt to fit it. And there wasn't one in West Branch that would fit the Nash. So finally they got the idea that maybe a screen door spring could be fastened around if made to run. So the Ford man called the hardware store man up and got him to open the store, and we got the screen door thing on it. By now it was late, because we'd stopped so many times before we got to West Branch. So we had supper, and Everett bought steak dinners for all of us. And we were all ravenous. We all ate our steak dinners, and we started home.
So there was no show?
Oh, no.
Oh, dear.
It was, we didn't even stop for a show in West Branch. It was just too late. And we didn't know how, you know, we had to get home. He had to take me all the way home yet. So we started out of West Branch, and for a little while it worked, and then it started slipping and slipping and slipping, and it just didn't work. So we lived on home, all the way home. We got Evelyn at her place, I don't know, 1 o'clock or something, and got to Roscommon, I think, around 3 o'clock. We got to my house at 5 o'clock.
In the morning.
My first date with Everett, and my dad was up and raring to go. His daughter was out all night. Oh, he was ready to go to town and see what had happened. Oh, yeah, he was an old-fashioned dad, and I knew how he would act. Well, anyway, and when we got to town, Abe said, Everett said, could I, you know, borrow your dad's car? Abe didn't have a car, but his dad had a car, and so it was really an old car, and we were so glad to get it. And we went home, as we drove in the car in the yard in this old car, and you know, my dad had seen the green Nash in there all shining and new, and here we come limping into this. So he believed our story all right when we told him the story. Well, he would have believed me anyway, but anyway, that was the story of my first date.
How long before you ever got to see the talkie?
I think we saw it in the, we never went to Bay City. No, we saw it at Gray Lake. Yeah. No, Gray Lake. There was no show in Roscommon. No. No. We used to go to something in the summertime called Chautauquas. Did you ever hear about those? That was a company that traveled from town to town, set up tents, and put on a play, a drama. And
what was the word you said?
Chautauqua.
Chautauqua.
C-H-A-T-A-U-Q-U-A or something like that. Chautauqua. Mm-hmm. Oh, and that was exciting.
Yeah.
I know what you paid.
Would have been in
In the cast? Oh, maybe 12, 15.
Yeah.
Uh-huh, they quite a few come moving, you know, then they'd have their movies and things. And they'd have one, they'd show it in Roscommon, they'd show it in Mayo, and they wouldn't show it maybe in a place like Grayling where they had the show, but they just go to little places like, you know, little towns where they didn't have a theater.
Mm-hmm.
And they always showed it, I think, twice on a Sunday.
Uh-huh.
They would show it in the afternoon and in the evening again.
Isn't that neat?
Mm-hmm.
So that was in the late 20s, early
30s? Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. I don't know about early 30s, but it would have been in early 20s,
before
mid-20s. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So when were you married?
Well, then Everett and I went together our first date was in 29, November 29, we were married in September 31. Mm-hmm. We had a nice home wedding, and there were 13 at our wedding. Just families and a friend or two. And we went to Petoskey on a honeymoon.
Did he still have the Nash?
No. No, he'd gotten a new car. He'd gotten a new Chevrolet. And on our wedding day, we started out after the wedding. We were married at 2 o'clock. And I know about 4:35 o'clock, we started out for to go to Petoskey. And we got to Grayling, and the car stopped.
Another car stopped.
And we didn't know what to do with it. We called Bertels. We had bought it from Bertels. Called them, and they towed us back to Roscommon and worked on the car until 9 o'clock that night. So we had dinner at the MacReady's house, and here they thought they'd gotten rid of us, you know. And we felt terrible. Kind of unnecessary. Yes. So anyway.
The wedding had been at your folks' house, though.
No, it was up there.
Oh, it was
on the hill.
House?
Yeah, in the living room up there.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And so we, and the Bergs brought the car, you know, drove it in and said, well, it's okay.
Uh-huh.
So we got as far as Sheboygan.
Oh.
And by now it was about midnight, I guess. I don't know what time we got really left up there, but anyway, it was about midnight. And we went in the hotel there, and we went up to the night clerk, and he said, well, what are you doing up here, Mac? And it was somebody that knew Everett from the store.
Oh,
and Everett said, my gosh, he said, I thought we were far enough away from home that no one would know us. So we just spent the one night up there, because that isn't where we wanted to be or whatever. So we went to Petoskey, and we found a beautiful bed and breakfast place. And we went in there, and it was just a lovely place. We had the whole upstairs to ourselves, beautiful place. And this was in September, so their tourist season was over, you know. And that's where I had my first permanent. Up until that time, I had...
On your honeymoon, you had a permanent?
Everett suggested I, because, you know, I just had my hair... And it was straight, you know. And I used to curl it, but that was a new thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, shoulder length. Mm-hmm.
Well, that was exciting.
Too. Oh, it was exciting, and it was a disaster from my standpoint. They put it on these rods, you know. And then they didn't set it like they do today. I looked like the snake lady or something like that. I wasn't worried about the curl in my hair anymore. But we had a lovely, lovely honeymoon up there. It was just wonderful weather, and every night we went to a place where we saw the sunset. We watched the sunset come down, and we had played the radio, and we just had a nice, just beautiful, and wonderful food, and walked by the beach, you know, just beautiful. Uh-huh. And then our last night we came home by way of Cadillac, and we went to the show there and had a nice dinner. And came home, we had 63 cents and about 3 gallons of gas. We just...
Right down
to the bottom. We had to come home. There was no... We couldn't afford to stay away any longer. But, yeah.
And then you lived...
We lived up there.
In the MacReady house?
Yeah. Everett MacReady had a house that we could have moved into, but it would have had been finished inside. And when he asked me where I wanted to live, I realized that he lived up there with his father, and Nell had graduated from college and couldn't find a job. It was depression. They weren't hiring
was
any
his
teachers.
His
mother
away?
Had passed away in 1925, I think.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And this was 31. And so I said to Everett, well, I think you'd like to live up there where you... His father every night asked him, well, tell me about the store. Tell me about the store. What happened today? And I could see that it was...
That,
yeah, I didn't want that. I knew his father.
So by that time, the father was not working in the store?
No, he was retired. So I moved up there, and it was a very happy decision. Everett said to me, I knew you'd make the right decision. So he was happy with that choice. And we had a good time. The father died 2 years later. He died in 34, really. And my father died the year after Everett and I were married, on my birthday.
Aww.
We had just been there to visit and share the cake and so on. And I was home about an hour when my brother came to the door and said, my father died. So we saw him at, you know.
Uh-huh.
It is a nice memory.
Was your mother still alive when you got married?
Oh, yes. Yeah, my mother's still alive. My mother lived to be 84.
Oh, she lived longer.
She went back to Chicago.
Oh, did she?
Oh, yes. She went back to Chicago, and that's where she stayed. She never came back. Yeah. She just went. That's where she wanted to be.
That's where her heart was.
That's where she wanted to be. Mm-hmm. Always. Anyway, and then George went. Got rid of the farm too.
George is your brother.
Mm-hmm. My brother George, and he was 19 when my father died, and or maybe 20. And my father died in November on my birthday, and George just stayed there through the winter, and then in the spring he leased the farm out.
Oh.
Just moved right out.
So
just
he
took
owned
his clothes.
It for a while yet, though.
Oh, he owned it until young. Maybe he just sold it about 10 years ago.
Oh, where did he go then? Did he come into Roscommon?
No, he went to not Chicago, but to Libertyville, where my aunt was.
Oh,
and then he went to California, and he was out there 5 years.
Oh.
Then he joined the Army.
Well, George got along, didn't
he? Yeah. Mm-hmm. But
and eventually George married.
Yeah, Nell lived with Everett and me for 13 years. Mm-hmm. And my brother George, well, all my family came to our home on vacations. And George came home on furlough. He was in the Army. He had volunteered. He joined the Army before the war began. And he was home on furlough during the war after he served on Nanette Island off the Alaskan coast. He'd been there for several years. So he had a long furlough. And
what island?
Nanette Island was part of the Aleutian chain off the coast of Alaska near Ketchikan. And so he came to visit us and stay with us during his furlough. And he and Mel started dating, and by the time he went back, they were engaged.
Well, once he got going, he didn't waste any time. Huh?
That's right. But by now they had known each other for quite a long time, because George used to spend Christmases with us, and he was with us quite a bit.
So you and Everett were the center of both of your families then, right?
Yes, we were. Mm-hmm.
Nice.
So we had a good life. And I enjoyed the business world. I enjoyed being with Everett in the store, although he didn't want me to work on a steady basis, and I never did. In the grocery store. But I did go down sometimes and help get things ready for a sale, make displays, and in those days you had to measure everything out.
Mm-hmm.
If things were in the bulk. And if we sold like 2 pounds of Fig Newtons for so much, well, we'd get them sacked.
Out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And
so how long did you live up on the farm? How much property was there? There was a house and what else?
120 acres with 340s along the road.
Oh.
And we lived up there 17 and a half years.
Oh, did you?
Mm-hmm. I did, and he lived there longer because he was there. Mm-hmm.
So how long had, are they the people that built that farm then? The Mercedes have had that farm built, that house?
No. That was the Johnson place, the Fred Johnson place. And he had a bunkhouse, he had men working for him. There was a real working farm, and those places, those acres were all fields.
Wow.
And he had quite a farm going.
So the Johnsons had homesteaded that? Or
I don't know if they homesteaded it. I don't know the Johnson history.
They had the house built.
It was a big, just a farmhouse, you know. There was a lovely farmhouse, and, but it had no, of course, it had no electricity or water or, when we lived there until we were there several years. We couldn't get electricity up there. We couldn't have anything.
You didn't come out that far from town?
No, and it would cost a fortune to bring it out because there weren't enough houses to share the expense. We would have had, until the Papenfusses moved up on that corner where the teepee is.
Oh, okay.
And Charlie put the cabins up and like that, you know. They helped pay. Yeah, after that we paid the electricity from Papenfusses.
That would be a wonderful event.
Was a wonderful event. Yes, that meant that we could have heat and water, we could have a furnace, you know. A lot of things came with that. So we were very happy with that. But it was a lovely place to live. A beautiful big orchard there. And it was all apples. And Everett's dad, while he lived, when they first moved up there, he decided he would have a little business going on his own. So he had three cabins built on that land.
And his name was?
Benjamin McCready. Mm-hmm. And the money that came in from the cabins was his spending money. That's the way he figured it. But he didn't do any of the work.
Who got to do that, Agnes?
Well, Agnes, and I did have a helper. I did have a housekeeper up there.
Well, yeah.
So, because we did all the washing and ironing for the whole store, and they wore white linen coats, white linen pants. They wore maybe two or three coats. And, you know, they carried, they got the meat in, they'd carry it in, and it would get on their coats. Then they would put on a fresh coat before they would serve the customers. So there was a lot of washing and ironing but I didn't mind it. I don't know, I was young and energetic it was part of my life, and I did it, you know. And we had a good life. Everett and I were married 3 years and 4 months before our son was born. And I remember those 3 years and 4 months as being free and carefree and, you know, some of the freest years of my life. We were just newlyweds, and I felt kind of unfettered, you know?
Uh-huh. I bet you were.
Uh-huh.
And it was did your sister come out to see you very often? I think he's gone by then already.
I don't have a younger sister.
Well, I thought you had Joe, your younger brother.
Oh, yes. My brother Joe came. Yes. Mm-hmm. Joe didn't like farming. My brother Andrew didn't like farming. So they left in their teens, or late teens, and went to Libertyville where my aunt lived. Everybody went to Libertyville. That was their base when they left here. And while they were looking for work and like that, they could live there and have a home.
Is the bear story something that we could share?
The bear? The bull? It's family legend.
Oh, well, we want to hear a legend.
Well, after George left the farm, he left everything, animals and everything, and we had this lovely family dog. And
this is at the Wagner farm.
At the Wagner farm. And Pete was our lovely dog. He was a wonderful dog, well trained. He was part shepherd and collie. He was just one of those mixes. Yeah, he was a beautiful looking dog and so intelligent. And really, we loved him. He could find the cows by himself and bring them home by himself. And he could go 3-4 miles to find those cows. And he could tell which were ours by the sound of the bells and probably look at the cows. And so when they saw Pete coming, they knew it was time for them to head for home. And they did. And we didn't even have to go look for our cows. Just send Pete. We'd say, okay, Pete, go for the cows, and he would go. No, he was just a wonderful dog. Anyway, so that we got word from the people who leased our farm, and they were, the man was Myrtle Papenfuss's uncle. His last name was Vance. Myrtle's first maiden name was Vance, and this was a Mr. Vance. I don't remember what his first name was now, but he was an uncle. And I think they had three children, three boys. anyway, they sent word that the dog was just pining. He was losing his hair, he was losing weight, he wasn't eating, he wasn't, he was just going to die of homesickness. So I went down to out front there to rescue the dog, and I got Pete and brought him home. And of course, Nell and Everett were kind of afraid of him because he was a good watchdog. When they came up, he thought they were strangers because I was the one that lived there. So, but they got used to them, and they learned to love him and respect him as we all did. Vi and Ham did too. Everyone loved that dog once they knew him. But anyway, Pete was this wonderful cow dog. And I kept telling Nell and Everett what a wonderful cow dog he was. So Will Love used to lease our land for his cows to graze.
Now this is the Love that had the Love Dairy?
He had the Love Dairy, okay. Uh-huh. And the cows that weren't milking, you know, he would put them in our, he would bring them over and pasture them in our fields, because we weren't doing anything to our fields, and they had been hay fields, so they had good,
and they were fenced.
And they were all fenced, very well fenced. And there was a fence between the fields and the orchard and the house and all that. Well, one day I looked out and I saw cows in the orchard. And this was in the fall, and the apples were down on the, you know, some of them were down, and they were eating apples. So and Nell was outdoors. And I said, Nell, watch Pete with the cows now. Now you can see what the cow, how he'll take care of the cows. I said, they're in the orchard, and I'm going to chase them back through the fence into the field. Nell said, okay. So she was back by the house, and I took Pete, and I said, come on, Pete, go get him, Pete. And oof, oof, he went. And all the cows turned around and went back through the fence into the field, except one. And that one wasn't a cow, that was a bull. And he lowered his head, and he let a bellow out of him, and he started for Pete. Pete ran out around me and in front of me, just like a bullet. So here was Pete, and I was in the middle, and the bull was behind me, so the three of us were racing down the orchard. And this bull did tromp, tromp, you know. And I was running as fast as I could, and I knew I couldn't make it to the house. We got down to the last tree in the orchard on that row, and I looked up and I saw this one limb sticking out, and I leaped for it, and I clung around it, my legs and my arms just as tight as I could. And the bull got to the tree and kept going round and round and huffing and puffing. He was just like you see a mad bull act. And I kept looking down, hoping he couldn't reach up, and he couldn't. I was up too high. Well, anyway, Nell said, Agnes, where are you? She said, all of a sudden, she didn't hear anything anymore. She didn't hear all this tromping. She saw this. And I said, Nell, I'm up in the tree. So she said, which tree? And I said, this apple tree, last month. So she said, what are you going to do? And I said, I want you to drive your car down under the tree, and I'll lower myself to the top of it, and you drive us to the porch, the kitchen porch, and we'll jump off and run in. And I said, blow your horn to scare the bull. Well, Pete by now was up on the kitchen porch where he was safe. He was. So Nell did what, did that, and the bull did back off. And I came down on top of the car, and you know, that's a hard thing to cling to. Oh, I thought I was going to slip off that. I was just lying flat, just clinging for my life. And she drove up to the thing, and we just raced in the house as fast as we could. And the bull followed us to the kitchen porch. He followed. He was so mad. So we stayed in there until he kind of lost interest, and then he went back. And that's the bull story. Well,
story.
That isn't all of it. So when we came, so whenever came home that night, we were telling him this bull story. And Everett said, show me that tree. So we went out to show him the tree where it was, and he looked up at that limb and he said, well, how did you reach that limb? And I said, well, I just jumped into it, just leaped into it. And he started jumping up trying to touch it. He couldn't touch it. Nell couldn't reach it. Nell jumped to reach it. Of course, I jumped.
You weren't even tall.
No, but I'll tell you, you don't know.
The Lord.
You know, people have said to me, it must have been your guardian angel. You know, it was almost impossible. But I did it. And I could, Everett said, you know, it's hard for me to believe it. Nell said, Everett, if I hadn't been here to see it, I don't think I would believe her. And I said, look at my arms. I remember what I wore. Wore a bright yellow dress. Maybe that's what scared the bull. I don't know. I wore bright, I wore a bright yellow dress and was sleeveless. And of course, it was quite short. And I was bare-legged, just sandals. So my legs and my arms were all scratched. Yeah. So I said, well, look at this. Here's your evidence. I was up in that tree. So that's my bull story.
That's
MacCready legend. Uh-huh. And they all tell it.
Well, sure. And you can't even embellish it. It's so good. Right?
Yeah, that's the true story. Well, then... Well, it's about 2 miles out of town. Is the house on the hill?
Schindeldecker's living there now.
Mm-hmm. White house with the red shutters. Mm-hmm. On the left side.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And I just loved that house. It had four beautiful big bedrooms, two upstairs and two down. Had a big walk-in closet upstairs with shelving so we could put extra things there.
That was pretty
nice. And it had a little trap door off there, and there was kind of a attic space that you could kind of crawl in. We put, for storage, we could put our Christmas things in there like that. So there was some space there. It wasn't big in closets, you know that. And but it had a kitchen that was just beautiful. When I think of that house now, I don't think of it as I saw it a year ago when I was in it. I think of it as I saw it when I lived in it. Mm-hmm. Because that was my doing, you know.
Sure.
And the kitchen.
You looked out to the back to the field, then. Was the orchard nearby then?
No, the orchard was off to the left.
Oh, okay.
And our garage that we had built, and the bunkhouse that was there when we first bought it, or lived there, we turned into a nice guest house. My mother lived there a whole summer. And Violet lived there a whole summer. It was just a cute little guest house. It was really cute. And it was a nice place for an extra guest. But Violet and Esther used to come home in summers. Esther taught in Chicago and I taught in Jackson. And they came home summers to spend their vacations here. And this was their home. And everybody always said, as long as we have a home, they were welcome to come. And they often brought friends, and we always found space for everybody. And we used to like to walk the fields at night, those open fields. It was just beautiful. They would smell of clover. We'd walk in the, fresh clover. We'd walk in the dew sometimes, and the mist would be rising. And I remember how much we enjoyed it. The whole groups of us, we'd have company and everybody would be walking the fields just
after dark,
in the moonlight or whatever. And we used to have lots of times I could play the piano and she could also play guitar. And we used to have sing-alongs, We enjoyed a lot of things together. And Vi and I used to spend many days at Kagan's Lake, just the two of us out there. And then in the evening, Nell and Everett would come from the store and they'd bring fresh fish or fresh meat or something. And while they had their swim, Vi and I would get the supper on. They'd bring canned beans or peas.
Where at the lake did you go?
Just the South State Park.
Oh.
We were often the only ones in.
Really?
Those days, it didn't cost a cent to get in. You could park your car anywhere. You could choose any one of many tables. There were the girls. It was very Maybe there'd be a family.
Those were the good old days.
Those were the good old days. Mm-hmm. Vi and I used to read to each other. We'd do our nails. We'd swim. We'd play and just whatever. Mm-hmm. It was good.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Then, 70 and a half years after that, Everett and I sold 40 acres. We sold it to the Brightons. Uh-huh. And she put up, and that was the first 40 acres. And she put up the
Coming Towards Town.
Coming Towards Town, uh-huh. And it starts just about where the restaurant is, and then it took in the house, you know, and just over the hill, just down to the bottom of the hill about. And we sold that because we had bought this house that I'm living in now, 1010 George Street in Roscommon, 2 years before that. This was in 1946 we bought this house. We moved into it in 1948. And we had it remodeled some. You know, we had to fix it up before we could move into it. We bought it from the Alice Marsh estate. We bought it really from Norm Marsh and his sister Alice, Mabel Howe.
Alice
had lived here. She had built a house in 36, and she had died in it in 40, 45, I think, because the house, or maybe 40, she lived in, I think, 8 years. So she would have died in 34, I guess, 44. Because it was empty for almost 2 years before we bought it. And in the meantime, I had the idea of starting a lady shop in town. I felt that there was need for a shop that would carry just a little higher priced line, a little better quality line than the dry goods store carried. They carried nice merchandise and a nice, but you didn't have a wide choice because they carried everything for men and boys and women, and they had household things and towels. So, you know, the variety wasn't great. And you had to really get out of town, UT, Bay City, or Traverse City to do any shopping of any, like Christmas or anything that you really shopped a lot for. So I just thought I would try that, and I was always interested in clothes. And I had been looking at, that time I took 14 magazines every month. Some were weekly, like the Saturday Evening Post and Collier's and Time and Life, and those magazines were weekly. And the others were like Good Housekeeping, Women's Home Companion, McCall's, and Red Book and so on, and Ladies' Home Journal. And I been looking at a lot of ads, and I always was interested in clothes, and I thought, oh, it'd be nice if we could buy some of these things in Roscommon. And I asked my husband about it, and he said, well, if you think you'd like to do it, I think it'd be a good idea. And there was an empty building, and that's what made me think of it in the first place. This building had been empty for several years and was brand new. It was the building that all the jewelry stores in it now. Gardner's Jewelry Store is in it now. And it belonged to Charlie DeWale, who was president of the Roscommon State Bank at the time. And he had built that series of stores, a row of stores. The Gamble store was in the middle, which...
So that was after that fire?
That was after the fire, uh-huh. And he built the building where Austin's store was in the corner, and the next store was the Gamble store, and his son-in-law, Bill Ingleson, ran that. And then there was the third building, which was empty. And I asked my husband what he thought about starting a little ladies' dress shop in there, and to my surprise he said, well, if you'd like to do it, go ahead. So I talked to Charlie DeWale about renting it, and he said yes. He said he'd had quite a few people ask about it, but he hadn't really wanted that kind of a business in there. But he said, yes, he thought he would like my kind of business in that store, in that place. So I leased it for 2 years. And I remember, he said to me, now remember, Agnes, whether you're occupying that building or not, you will owe me rent for 2 years. And I realized then he didn't expect me to to be very successful. He was expecting me to fail. And I said, yes, Mr. DeWale, I understand that. And I was in there for almost 18 years, but not in that building. I was in this building for almost 13 years, and then I went on to the other one.
Oh, the first one you went 13 years?
Well, now, wait a minute. I think it was longer than that, maybe. Okay. Anyway, so the building was just emptied. We had to put in the shelving and the everything, you know.
So you bought all that?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So that was quite an undertaking. And then my husband and I didn't know where to go to shop for to fill a whole building full of things. And I thought, where would I start? Well, we got thinking and talking around, and we decided to go to Chicago to the Merchandise Mart and start from there. And that was a good beginning. My sister lived in Chicago, and so we could stay there. And we went there, and I guess we shopped for a whole week or something the first time we went.
So Everett went with you?
Everett went with me. Oh, yes, he always went with me.
Oh, that was nice.
He loved it. And we both really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. So we went to the Merchandise Mart, and the first man I saw, well, that is a building just full of merchandise. Floor after floor after floor, and they have their displays, big lit up windows, you know, inside. And you just walk the floors and look at everything, and they have their brand names and everything. So I decided to stop in this one place that had the kind of merchandise I thought would sell in Roscommon. They were t-shirts and shorts and slacks, and I was shopping for spring and summer. And so I thought, this looks good. And there's a man sitting in there, a young man, and no one was with him at the time. There was no buyer in there, I think. So we went in there and introduced ourselves and told him that we were starting out. And he was so kind. He became one of our favorite people. He became a friend as well as a business person. And he helped us find places down there to go. He told me where to find hats and where to look for different things. You had to go to different buildings for a lot of things. There's whole areas that are nothing but warehouses buildings that sell that kind of merchandise, wholesale. So anyway, this was Tony, and I don't remember his last name, but we entertained him here in our home for dinners and like that. He became a friend. And all the sales ladies were always glad when Tony came. And those were the days when the salesmen came through and brought their merchandise and showed it to you. That's long gone, you know, you have to go now. And of course it's become too expensive for them to travel. But anyway, that's how we got started. And Tony was very careful what I bought and what he knew the Northland, because he knew Joseph at Great Lake. He sold them. So he knew a little bit about the Northland. And I don't think Roscommon hadn't made any impression on him. He didn't even remember Roscommon because he had no stop here. But when he came through in the fall and he asked me how much I had left of his merchandise, I think I had 3 pieces left. And he said to me, I know you're going to be successful.
Really?
He said, the way things sold this summer in here, I know you're going to be successful. But anyway, yes. And we started out just ladies' merchandise, and then I had a gift shop. Half of it was gift shop on the left side, and the other half was ladies' merchandise. And I had that about 5 years, and I realized then that the gifts didn't sell every day of the year. They sold certain periods, holidays. August was a good time because people were taking gifts home to their families and guests. And like Mother's Day, and you know, just certain days that they bought these kind of things, Christmas and so on. And bridge, people would buy them for bridge gifts, you know, bridge prizes. And I remember Ella Soderholm, when she gave a wedding gift or something, she always came in for a silver candle snuffer. That seemed to be her favorite gift. And anyway, eventually I closed out the gifts, and by now so many people had asked me to carry children's merchandise. There's no place. So, children's clothing. So I put in a children's line and took the gifts out, and that was a good decision. And then later on I carried shoes. I hadn't carried shoes to start with. But my two sisters-in-law gave me no encouragement at all. They said, Agnes, we don't think it'll go. My one sister-in-law worked in our grocery store, and they all worked there, and she said, Agnes, they can't pay for the groceries. How are they going to pay for anything else? And I said, oh, Nell, I'll just give it a try. And she said, well, you'd have to take in at least $500 the first day if you to be successful. And she said, in March, just before income tax and everything, she said, I don't think you can do that. And I took in $579 the first day, which was pretty good because, yes, because, you know, you could buy a beautiful blouse for $1.98, $2.98. And, oh, I advertised. Oh, I did. I advertised. I should find my old newspapers because weeks before, I just kept saying, watch this space for an exciting announcement, you know. And I never said what it was going to be. I just kept saying, keep watching this space, you know. And then we got working inside. Of course, they knew it was going to be something.
Sure.
But we had the windows all blacked out, you know. So anyway, it was fun. It was fun. Mm-hmm. And my two first clerks were Marie Hodges and Iris Nibbs. Her name was Hill at that time. They were the two that I, my helpers the first year or so. Mm-hmm. So then after several years, I realized my building was too crowded and too small, and I had to build another building. But before that happened, my husband and I had decided to demolish the grocery store.
Oh,
because
how did you phase out of that?
Well, we had big sales, and we decided it was either move to another area and build a new grocery store because there wasn't parking enough. We realized we were, you know. Uh-huh. But in the meantime, we'd been approached by the Sunoco Oil Company, who wanted us to put a gas station on that corner. And they would give us the franchise, but we had to build it to their specifications and so on. So we had to buy more land, and Esther owned it, so we bought land from Esther. Yeah, 30 feet we had to buy from Esther. And since then, after that, I bought 27 more. So I bought.
So was that house gone already? The house that had been behind it?
Yes.
That was the contract?
Mm-hmm. That was gone when we built, because Esther had bought the land, and I don't know what happened to the house, but the house was gone.
So the McCready house then, that had been there, that had started.
Mm-hmm.
You took all that down at
mm-hmm.
that time?
We took all that down. Mm-hmm. Because no one had lived in that.
And that was what? 50?
That was in 51.
Oh,
well, in 49 is when we demolished it. In 51, we opened the station. No, wait a minute. 51. 51, we did it all. Labor Day, 51, every night started. the big sale and so on. And
the
we,
store.
Yeah.
So you had two stores at that time. You had yours.
I had mine and he had his. I had started mine in 48. And now this was 2 years later, or 3 years later. And so we, well, we had our sale earlier in September. We had it before the people went back, you know. And then we started demolishing the store in September. And the 13th day of November, we opened our new station. So we had a big...
You must have hired big crews.
Well, Garrett Nolan and Howard Bartenfelder put it up. And Everett and I drew up the plans, pretty much, with the help of Sunoco people. They had to have certain feet for driveway and like that, so. But, in about 3 months we were in it.
It was
a big change. It was a big change for my husband from selling meat and groceries all his life to selling gas and so on. But we had a wonderful business right from the very beginning. And the Sunoco gas was very popular at that time. That's when Thomas, you know, used to talk about Blue Sunoco.
Oh.
And he was the commentator, the news commentator. Everybody listened to Lowell Thomas. He advertised the Blue Sunoco gasoline, you know. And it was going just great guns. All the salesmen that came to visit me always say, well, I'll go up now and fill up at your gas station, you know. And they all burned Blue Sunoco. So anyway, yes, it was very successful. We were very happy with it. And we had it for many years until I sold it about 4 or 5 years ago. 5, 6 years ago. Mm-hmm. Yeah, long time. So then, and in 1963, I had the station built, the new village shop built, 62 or 63.
And that's the building that is now the Village of Congression.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I was, Mr. DeWitt's crew built that.
Roy DeWitt.
Roy DeWitt. And I drew up the plans for that. Mm-hmm. And I was very happy with that building, and it was a very good move on my part. My business just
Had you rented
boomed.
All the previous time?
No, no, I bought that.
I
bought it after Everett died.
Oh,
I did.
Did you sell that?
Well, I made a deal with Mr. DeWitt.
Oh.
And incorporated into this other deal.
Oh.
Buying. I told him, I called him here one day and I said, Roy, I have a proposition for you. If you take this building off my hands, and we had a deal, you know, I told him what I wanted and so on. And then I said, then I can go ahead, because he'd been wanting me to build there. Andy Sherman had his built a year or so before that, and Roy had been wanting me to fill that space in between. And I knew it would be a good idea, but for a while I didn't know how I could do it. But then when I got to thinking about it, I thought it would be a good move, and it was. It really was a good move. Mm-hmm. And we were able to add new lines, and we really had good business. Well, Rich, Coretta, California. Uh huh. White Stag, Lample, Jim Wright's, and Buster Brown for children, and Paul Parrott for the shoes. And I used to read consumers' reports, you know, and find out what was the best, and used to do an awful lot of reading. I got Women's Wear Daily, read that every day, and you think that came out of New York, and you think it wouldn't apply here, but it did. It told you just exactly the new trends and the new colors and which companies were doing well and which lines were doing well. And I used to take it to bed and read it every night. I also got the Wall Street Journal, read that every night.
So you've always been a voracious reader.
I have been a voracious reader. Uh-huh. And I loved it. I mean, I was just immersed in all that, and I really liked it. And after I sold it...
Good people work for you.
Oh, wonderful people. Yeah, she came to work 3 months and stayed 14 years with me, and then she kept on with the Shervins for another 20 years, I think. Mm-hmm. She loved the Thelma. She was, oh, she liked that business and liked that store. Everyone liked Thelma.
So when did you sell to Shervin?
In 65, August of 65. Alan and Kathleen. Uh-huh.
And
they loved it.
When did it close?
25 years later, I think, or 30 years later. Let me think now. It was 65, 75, 85. That was in the mid-80s, I think they sold it. Mm-hmm. And everybody still mourns it.
We do. We still have the Valley Shop.
Yeah. It was a happy, happy time.
Is there any more to tell about living here on the river?
Well, one thing, when I first moved up here from Chicago, I couldn't, the thing I kept telling everybody, as soon as I'm 18, I'm going back to Chicago. I miss Chicago so much. And then I began to enjoy nature. I took long walks. I always loved to walk, and I was always someone that noticed everything. And I loved the wildflowers. And out there, the land, the woods were full of trillium and arbutus and marigolds. And we used to play at the creek, you know, in the creek, and the bags would be just full of marigolds. And
you mean El Dorado?
El Dorado, land of promise, or whatever it's called.
Is that what it means?
That's what it means. Promises they don't keep. But anyway, I learned to love, and the trees, and our land. My father's homestead was the only one that still had large Norway pines. And you could hear the swish and the sway, and it always sounded like water on the beach. And my people that came to visit us from Chicago, and we had people up there every summer from Chicago visiting, they'd always say, well, there must be a lake nearby. I can hear the waves. And it was just the swaying of, there's always a sound in Norway trees. Mm-hmm. And we loved it. And I can remember my dad never went to bed without first opening the kitchen door and looking toward those pines and listening. And we all were so aware of those lovely pines. And Dutch Shepherd came out several times and wanted to buy the timber. And we had people from Bay City, from the different timber, the sawyers and the timber people, come to try to buy those trees. My dad would not sell one of them. But eventually, we had to sell, and George sold them to Papenfuss. They became matured. Yeah, they were mature. You know, there comes a time when you know it's best. But they saved a lot of the young trees, you know. So there's a new growth there. But I learned, and we used to go skiing winter nights, all of us. And, oh, just loved it. Every time there was moonlight, we'd say to the Kreitzer kids who lived a half mile from us, well, meet you after supper for skiing, you know. We'd meet at a certain place between the two places, and we'd all ski. Just loved it. And I always liked skiing and walking.
Well, it's nice we got back to El Dorado, because I want to ask you about the Rock Cemetery.
Oh.
And I'm telling us about what Memorial Day is. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, when I was 10 years old, my sister died up here. She was 20. And we buried her at this little cemetery in the woods. Rock Cemetery is called. And it was named after a great big stone that's up there. And now they have put a little white fence around it. But then it was just a big stone back there. And on Memorial Day, we used to gather all the people who had a member of the family there, and practically all the neighbors in that little neighborhood had someone there. And if not, they were friends of someone who was there. Practically the whole neighborhood met there.
What were there some of the other family names?
Wienus, Funches, Williams, Hartmans, Daryl Matheson's mother's mother was there, and that's Smith. I've been out there with Winnie to look at that grave. But I don't remember them being there when we were there. But it was mostly the neighborhood. And we would come and we would have a ceremony. We had a flagpole there, and we would raise the flag and pledge allegiance, and we would sing America, and maybe Mrs. Funch, Maddie Funch, who was the matriarch up there, and everyone respected her and loved Maddie. Very outspoken Christian woman. She would read something or, you know, say a prayer or something. And everyone would go to each other's graves and remember if we knew the person, you know. And
we went around
together with each other, and kind of talked again. And if, now the Funches had apple orchards. We didn't have any fruit trees. And sometimes our lilacs wouldn't be in bloom in time, and maybe we wouldn't have too much to put on the grave. I would go through the field or through the woods and look for flowers to take to the graves, And you could always usually find something. But if there was such a time that you didn't have, some of us didn't have the flowers and the others did, they would share. And it was really a nice time, a nice family time together. We might be up there an hour or two, and then everyone get in their horse and buggy, or a few of them came in cars, and whatever.
But that was every Memorial Day?
Every Memorial Day, yeah.
And what was your sister's name?
Cecilia. Cecilia, I think Marie.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful girl. Long hair. I'd like to have that picture enlarged.
Yeah.
And
color. Sure.
And today there's my father's buried there. George's wife Nell is there. And my mother. And there's a place for George. And then that lot will be filled. There's only room for one more. And George has his stone there already. But it's a nice cemetery.
Oh, so
pretty and restful. And everyone that sees it likes
it's
it.
It's nice because it's small.
It's well kept and it's peaceful. So those are some of the memories.
So one thing, aren't I remember your talking about reading poetry?
Oh, yes. We used to have what we called a Friday night, literary night it was called. And it was up at the El Dorado schoolhouse. And every Friday night, or maybe it was once a month, I don't remember. Maybe in the winter it was once a month, but they would light the lamps, the Funches would go down early and get things going. If it was winter, they'd light the lamps and get the fire going. And we would, anyone could do anything they wanted. They could tell jokes, they could sing a song, but they wanted everyone to take part that could, you know. And we all went because everyone brought food. Was a little, after we said our little pieces and like that, we'd have a lunch and we'd all go home. And I guess us kids walked up. My brother Andrew, my sister Ann, and I don't think the little boys went. But I remember walking up. And it didn't seem a long walk in those days. Because maybe some of the other people gave you a ride halfway home or something, you know. Or maybe they walked with you halfway home or whatever. And I remember it. Oh, and I think there was a piano in there. Because I think Grace played the piano. She was educated in music. She'd had a good education. And Boyd was a lovely singer, so I think he would sing.
So that was a nice social.
That was a nice social thing. And I remember I was so excited the first time. I was like, 8 years old. I went up there and I said, I have a little shadow that goes in and out with me. And what can be the use of it is more than I can see. It follows, I don't know, it follows me, something, and jumps before me when I go to bed or something like that. It goes on and on.
That was my first
one. My in the public in front of the people.
Okay.
So I remember that.
Sure. Give us a little rundown on the Funches, because they were, or El Dorado.
Well, Mrs., when we moved here, there was a beautiful old white farmhouse with the typical, the big porch, you know, and it was a lovely house. And this beautiful, beautiful, big, big birch tree was down, not real close to, but down in front of it, between that and the gate. And that always impressed me. So the big, first you saw the big birch tree that was really big. I think it was several trees all together. You know, birches often grow in groups. And then you came to this house, and Mrs. Crane lived in it. She was Grace's mother, they were Grace's mother and father. Very formal people, I think, from England.
Grace's
Funch's mother and father, Mr. and Mrs. Crane. And they had the post office. Mrs. Crane was the postmistress. And you could buy stamps and pencils and paper and envelopes.
Right in the house.
Right in the house. She had it, the first room right off the porch. And they were very formal. And they would, Mr. Crane would call her Mrs. Crane, and she would call him Mr. Crane.
Oh, really?
What they said in private, I don't know. But in public, they were always Mr. and Mrs. Crane to each other. Yes. And... So anyway, after the Crane stopped officiating that way, Grace took over.
She was their only child.
She was their only child, and she was married to Boyd Funch. How they came to be up there, I don't know. Mr. Crane was not a farmer, and yet I guess they had the garden and chickens, maybe, and like that. And then Boyd was an only son of Maddie's, and her husband had died quite young, and she was a widow that lived up in that little log house there that you've seen.
Oh, yeah, she was nearby.
Uh-huh. And Boyd and Grace met each other up there and married. And they were...
So you're familiar with Nancy McCann?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She was quite a character. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was a colorful person.
So, Grace and Boyd, they have a family.
They have one son, Robert. Uh-huh.
Oh, just one son.
Yes, uh-huh.
And then did he carry on? How long did the post office stay there?
Well, until it was closed down by the federal government. And it had quite a write-up in the paper. I think I have the clipping of it. Mm-hmm. I have more clippings of things that I must go through.
Yeah.
I guess maybe you'll have to help. Yeah, I think I need your help.
Yeah.
I don't think I'll ever get into all this unless you help me. But I think I have a lot of things you would like.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
That'd be great.
I know I have that. And I can't tell you when it closed down.
Yeah, because you moved in last time.
Yes. Oh, yes. It was open many years after that. The mailman used to stop there. That was the halfway house in the years ago, the winter time. He would drive from Roscommon to El Dorado and spend the night, and then go on to Mayo, and then the next day, and spend the night there, and the next day come back to El Dorado and spend the night and go back to Roscommon.
Is that when he was still with the horse?
Yes. That'd be in the wintertime with the horses. Yeah, otherwise, they made the trip in one day, in the summertime. And later on, Roy Griffin had the job. Well, Mrs. Fry's husband was killed delivering the mail in the wintertime. They were living up opposite the El Dorado house, the post office. There's a white building opposite. Was used to be the Hartman Ranch. And the Frys were living in that house. And Mr. Fry was delivering the mail to Mile. And I don't know where the horses bolted, but they did, and he was killed. He fell out under the sled or something and trying to stop them, and he was killed, like Mrs. Fry with the three little girls.
Mm-hmm. Is that the same Mr. Fry that was in the
National
Museum? Is that about Elmer Scott's
grandfather? Yes. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. That's who. Mm-hmm. So,
you remember the Hiscock family from like that way?
No, I remember the name. I never knew the family. The ones I knew from out there were the Weenus. And I guess on the cooks lived out there. And the cooks and the, what was the other name? Can't think of it now. But there were two other families that lived out there. Oh, Cones. Mansell Cone was a son-in-law.
Oh, C-O-H-N?
C-O-N-E, I think.
Oh, Chris Parker's
name. I think so. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think you've given us quite a little report here on El Dorado and Rock County. And the Cree family. And the Wagner family.
Yeah.
So, is can you think of anything else?
I think that's pretty good report.
I think we did pretty Well, thank you very much, Agnes. We appreciate your time and effort to do this for us. This is not an easy thing. But I think that we're set unless you can think of something else.
Well, I could tell you that my son got married in, I don't know the year, but he was like 22 or 3, I think. 22, Anthony McCready,
yeah.
And he died when he was 28, the result of an automobile accident, and had three children, and they are fully grown now, and they're the blessings to me now.
You're very even a grandmother.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Hard to believe it. And they're all in the area.
They're all living in the area. Mm-hmm. And I now have grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Mm-hmm. And I'm very happy for that.
And you have a couple nephews on your side of the family.
Oh, yes. My sister Anne is 93 and still living. And she has two bachelor sons who are now retired. And they're all living in Florida. And I see them quite often. Once.
And the Crees have 8 children of 10.
Mm-hmm.
Those are their only nieces and nephews, right?
Yes, nieces and nephews, and they're quite close to me. We keep in touch and see each other quite often.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been a full life.
They all like to come to Ross County.
They all like Ross County.
Sure.
My place has always been the meeting place.
Tell what Ann calls Ross County.
The little town that cares. She thinks it's so beautiful and shows it. She thinks the flowers and the streets and everything really look beautiful. That's what it is. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Agnes. We'll be all set.
All right,
okay?
Carol.